BGMC. The biblical truth lives here.
The ancient Hebrew scriptures foretold of the Anointed One, Yeshua HaMashiach. The Messiah Yeshua came to call the people back to the truth of His word and to follow that righteous path. Yeshua then called Jewish men to be His disciples, and after His death and resurrection, those Jewish men told the world about the Jewish Messiah. Now, after 2,000 years, Beth Goyim Messianic Congregation has that same calling of those Jewish men, telling all people, both Jew and Gentile, about the proper ancient path, teaching the Route 66 King's Highway from Genesis through to Revelation, and how you need and can get back to the proper roots of the faith and a closer walk with God. Now, let's hear the message.
Let's go get a blessing. Turn to the book of Romans. Romans chapter 2. Romans chapter 2. Romans chapter 2. This is the message number P254. P254. Romans 2. The spiritual circumcision. Romans 2. The spiritual circumcision. P254. Let's read a little synopsis of what we're going to learn tonight. What is the real biblical meaning to a circumcised heart? If one does not have this circumcised heart, can they enter into the kingdom of God? Rav Sha’ul, Paul, writes to the Messianic Congregation in Rome about being a real Jew. What does he mean about true inward circumcision? The only way to comprehend what Rav Sha’ul, Paul, means is by reading the and comprehending what he would have been reading. Since the Brit HaDasha was not written, what then was Rav Sha’ul reading? Amen? Let's start off in the book of Romans. We're going to go to our foundation scripture for this message. Romans chapter 2. Romans chapter 2, verse 28 and 29. This is our foundation scripture. We're going to learn about what it means to be spiritually have a circumcised heart. A circumcised heart. What does that mean biblically? Well, let's start out with what Paul wrote to the Messianic congregation in Rome. Okay? Romans chapter 2, verse 28 and 29. For the real Jew is not merely Jewish outwardly. True circumcision is not only external and physical. On the contrary, the real Jew is one inwardly. And true circumcision is of the heart. Spiritual, not literal, so that his praise comes not from other people, but from God. Amen? Now, as I said in the synopsis, what would Rav Sha’ul be reading? Is he reading the New Testament? Is he reading the letters to Ephesians? Maybe at this point in Romans chapter 2, he hasn't written it. So what we're going to be learning tonight is what these two verses are all about, that so many Gentiles have a difficult time understanding, and they really misunderstand it in a great way to their own demise, what is going to be their own demise, because they don't understand what biblical spiritual circumcision is all about. Okay? A real Jew is merely not Jewishly outwardly. A circumcision is not only external, but internal. What does that mean? What is Paul talking about? Because he says external and internal. I know in some translations it read, like I read a couple other translations, I'm like, what did you just say? Actually, the Stern translation of the Brit HaDasha here actually nailed it very well. Okay? But the real Jew is not merely Jewish outwardly. You know, it's great to wear a tallit. It's great to have a long beard if you like long beards that don't get stuck in your tallit clips. Okay? Is it great to wear tzitzit real long and, you know, say prayers real long? And, you know, what is real circumcision? Circumcision is not only external, but in physical. On the contrary, a real Jew is, he's talking about inwardly. What is he talking about? Okay? What is this true circumcision of heart? Well, we're going to take a ride through the Torah, a couple of parts of the Torah. We're going to take a ride through a couple of prophets. Then we're going to go to Romans 2 again. And I think we're going to go to Colossians, or maybe Corinthians, to see what this circumcision is. But you remember, this is a Jewish book, okay? You must understand it through the eyes of the Old Testament. The Old Testament wasn't done, okay? When Yeshua said it's finished on the cross, what did he mean? He said his job here was done, okay? He finished the race, as Rav Sha’ul eloquently puts it later on. Rav Sha’ul, for those that are new, is Paul. He is a Jew. His name was Sha’ul, okay? Now let's see what he's talking about. Let's read verse 28 and 29 again. For the real Jew is not merely Jewish outwardly. True circumcision is not only external and physical. On the contrary, the real Jew is one inwardly, and true circumcision is of the heart. Spiritual, not literal, so that his praise comes from other people but from God. Amen? Why would God want to praise you? Why would the King of all creation, let me fix this tallit, it's really giving me a problem here tonight. Why would the King of kings, the Lord of all creation, why would he want to praise you? Why would he want to give you a good, like, pat on the back? Why would he want to do something like that? What is Rav Sha’ul talking about? Okay, let's start off this journey on this Erev Shabbat, this message, P254, Romans 2, the spiritual circumcision. What is he talking about? Okay, we have to go back to what Rav Sha’ul would have access to, what books that he would have access to, what each Jew would have access to, and that would be what? The Torah. So let's turn back to Devarim, Deuteronomy chapter 30. Devarim, Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 1 through 6. Devarim 30, Deuteronomy chapter 30. Sorry, I didn't say Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 1 through 6. If you allow him to do open heart surgery, this section is called. Okay, I'll give you a second to find it while I pop a little throat lozenger in my mouth here. All right. When the time arrives that all these things have come upon you, both the blessing and the curse, which I presented to you, and you are there among the nations to which Jehovah your Elohim has driven you, then, at last, you will start thinking about what has happened to you. And you will return to Jehovah your Elohim and pay attention to what he has said, which will be exactly what I'm ordering you to do today. You and your children with all your heart and with all your being. At that point, Jehovah your Elohim will reverse your exile and show you mercy. He will return and gather you from all the peoples to which Jehovah your Elohim has scattered you. If one of yours was scattered to the far end of the sky, Jehovah your Elohim will gather you even from there. He will go there and get you. Jehovah your Elohim will bring you back into the land your ancestors possessed, and you will possess it. He will make you prosper there, and you will become even more numerous than your ancestors. Then Jehovah your Elohim will circumcise your hearts and the hearts of your children, so that you will love Jehovah your Elohim with all your heart, with all your being, and thus you will live. Amen? Now, before getting to verse 6 and coming to the land of Israel, you first have to do something first. Let's go back to verse 1 and see what this spiritual circumcision is all about. What is this spiritual circumcision all about? It starts in verse 1. When the time arrives that all these things have come upon you, both the blessing and the curse, which I presented to you, and you were there among the nations to which Jehovah your Elohim has driven you, then at last you will start thinking about what has happened to you. Amen? Okay? So the first thing that has to happen is you have to say, I don't want this anymore. I don't want to live among these people anymore. I'm tired of explaining Shabbat. I'm tired of trying to tell them I need Shabbat off. Okay? I'm tired of telling them that I need this holy day off. You know, they take their Sundays off, they take their Easter off, they take their Christmas off. Okay? What what you need to understand, okay, is that you, the first part of a spiritual circumcision is you have to do something. You have to turn your focus from inward to upward. Let me say that again. For spiritual circumcision to begin, this is what Rav Sha’ul is talking about. This is the beginning part of what Rav Sha’ul is talking about in Romans 2. The first part is that you have to change your focus from in to up. From in to up. The first part of this is that both the blessings and the curses have come to you, and you're there among the nations that God has driven you. So the first, then you got to start thinking about, well, what has happened? Why are these things happening? Why are these good things happening? Why are more bad things happening than good? Why is there this terrorist attack? Why is there this terrorist attack? Why are the Chinese doing this? Why are the people doing this? Why are they doing that? You start thinking, you go, I'd rather be home in Israel. Okay? I'd rather be in God's house. Okay? Why? The first part, then you say to yourself, why was I driven away? Why did I leave God's house? Okay? First part of spiritual circumcision is to say, why did I leave? Maybe I was never there. And to say, I got to get there. Okay? Why are my people being oppressed? Okay? Then, you know, for the Jewish people, you have to ask yourself, well, why was the temple destroyed? What was the purpose? Why did God allow the temple to be destroyed? Okay? Why are we living amongst the nations since we have a homeland of Israel? Okay? This is because we had an uncircumcised heart. Okay, the first part of spiritual circumcision is realizing that you need a circumcised heart, that you need circumcision. Okay, the first part that we then move on to is that you realize that there's a problem. Okay, that you realize that you have a problem. Okay, you think that everything is peachy king and you don't need God? Hey, go ahead, live without him. One day you'll realize, okay, one day you'll realize that it's a real problem. But those of us see things that are coming, see the world really starting to fall apart. Two volcanoes erupting today, 7.7 earthquake in the middle of, I think, the Pacific Ocean. Okay, so, you know, you got all these crazy things going on. You got, you know, all this flooding, this fire happening in America. You got a 1,500 mile storm hitting England tonight, dropping the temperature to 51 degrees or 11 degrees Celsius. Okay, it's getting very cold there already. And you got all these rapes and things going on from the Muslims throughout Europe. Okay, so you're saying there's something wrong here. So the first part that we have to do is realize that we need some sort of circumcision. Okay, let's go on to verse 2. Verse 2. And you will return to Jehovah your Elohim and pay attention to what he has said, which will be exactly what I'm ordering you to do today. You and your children with all your heart and all your being. Amen? So step number 2 that Rav Sha’ul is talking about in Romans 2 about this inward circumcision is that you have to pay attention to whom? Okay? You have to pay attention to whom? Pay attention to what God has said. Okay, the first part of what understanding what Romans 2 is all about this circumcision, is that you have to return to Jehovah your Elohim and what? Pay attention to what he has to say. Okay, not to what religion has to say, not to what the Talmud has to say, not to what Christianity has to say, to what God has to say. Okay, there's many people that I've seen recently, and especially this very interesting documentary that I watched that was really fantastic. There's a lot of people questioning what they're doing with God. A lot of Christian pastors saying, well, why are we doing Sunday? Can we find somewhere in the Bible where it says move to Sunday? Can we find some? I want to be like Messiah. There's a lot of people saying, I want to be like Messiah. So the first part to be like Messiah is, let's read verse 2 again. And you will return to Jehovah your Elohim and pay attention to what he has said, which will be exactly what I'm ordering you to do today. You and your children with all your heart, with all your being. Amen? So the first part of this circumcision and returning to God is what? Is you have to say, I don't like what's going on. Then you say, I got to return back to his word to follow Yeshua's example. Okay, that's the first part that we got to start walking through. This part that we have to start walking through is paying attention to what Jehovah said, not what the rabbis say, not what Talmud says, the Babylonian or the Jerusalem Talmud, whichever one you want to follow. You got to just follow what God said. Okay, you know, I meet a lot of Jewish people, and they see me walking around with my tzitzit on. That's not so bad. But they see the blue thread in my tzitziot. I'm like, well, what did God say? You know, what does God say? In Bimbar 15, what does he say? Put the tekel in. Well, we don't know what color tekel. I don't think God really minds what color blue you use. He just said tekel, a blue thread. Okay? We return to what and pay attention to what Jehovah says. The first part of a circumcised heart is returning, is realizing that you got a problem. Part two then is returning and paying attention to what Jehovah says. Okay? Look at verse 6 now. Devarim, verse 6. Devarim 30, verse 6. Then Jehovah your Elohim will circumcise your hearts and the hearts of your children so that you will love Jehovah your Elohim with all your heart and with all your being, and thus you will live. Amen? Amen? So once you return and you show that effort to paying attention to what God has said, then what he says he's going to do is then he's going to bless you. He's going to bless you. He's going to circumcise the rest of your heart. He's going to make it easy. But what it has to be is that you must show an effort first. You must say, I want this. I want the good stuff. And then Jehovah says, I like what my kid's doing. I see their effort. You know, sort of like in our school, when the kid is trying, you want to help them even more. Okay? When you see people design, when they come in here to our congregation here at Beth Goim, what I like when people do ask questions, but when they're asking questions with a searching heart. Like, tell me. I'm not, you know, I want to know. I want to know what this is. And that's what's going on a lot more around the globe. People are saying, I want to be like the Lord. I want to be like Messiah. Show me where it says to do that. Okay? You know, a lot of people do, they come into Messianic Judaism and they want to be Jews, and they saw a fiddler on the roof, and what do they do? What do they do on Friday night? They take the two candles, the lady does this whole thing, na 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 na, three times, and she covers her eyes. And that's all Talmudic. Don't do that. Don't do Talmud. Do what the Lord says in his word. And then he says, I'll circumcise the rest of your heart. And not only that, I'm going to circumcise the hearts of your children. Look at verse 6 again. It's a blessing because it comes from the second commandment. Then Jehovah your Elohim will circumcise your hearts and the hearts of your children so that you will love Jehovah your Elohim with all your heart, with all your being, and thus you will live. Amen? Okay, so we're Messianic believers. What is the definition of love? Hold your place there. We're going to go look at what Yeshua says the definition of love is. Hold your place there in Devarim, Deuteronomy 30. Turn over to John 14, verse 15. John 14, Yochanan 14, verse 15. John 14, verse 15. We're going to see out of Messiah's own lips what he says the definition of love is. John 14, verse 15. You should know this by heart already. We've done it many times, but it's part of this particular teaching. If you love me, you will keep my commands. Amen? If you love me, you will keep my commands. Amen? He doesn't specify only these five, only these two. What he does say, if you love me, you will keep my commands, okay? Since he and the Father are one, what then would he mean? Circumcise your hearts, okay? Then he'll circumcise the hearts of your children. Love your Elohim with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. What does that mean? It means wanting what God wants, okay? Desiring what God wants. If you love me, if you love the Lord your God, if you love Yeshua, if you want to be like him, then you're going to keep the commands no matter what anybody says, not even if you're misunderstanding what Paul is writing. But we're learning what Paul is really writing. He's confirming the Torah, not denying the Torah in Romans and his other writings. Okay? If you love me, you will keep my commands. Okay? Now let's go back to Deuteronomy 30, verse 6. Deuteronomy 30, verse 6. Deuteronomy 30, verse 6. Then Yehovah your Elohim will circumcise your hearts and the hearts of your children so that you'll love Yehovah your Elohim with all your heart and with all your being, and thus you will live. Amen? So a circumcised heart gets you life. A circumcised heart gets you life. Circumcised to what? What is he talking about? Circumcised, and that goes back to the other previous verses that we read. What did we read? We read verse 1 and 2. And in verse 1, it talks about not wanting the curses anymore, but wanting the blessings. And in verse 2, you return to what Yehovah your Elohim has said. Then you will learn to love with all your heart, and you will live. Conversely, what is the antonym theory of that? What is the antonym of that? What do you think is the antonym of that? If you don't circumcise your heart, you don't choose what God wants, Yehovah your Elohim wants, then he's not going to circumcise the heart of your children, and he's not going to allow you to live. Okay, well, what is living? Well, Deuteronomy 28, verse 4, 1 through 14 says, I'll bless you in the house, I'll bless you in the farm, I'll bless you in the land, I'll bless you with prosperity, I'll bless you, all these wonderful things. That's living. What is not living? I'm going to curse you in the land, I'm going to have fire, you know, 45 miles worth of fire going on in California right now, 45 miles of fire, okay? The Lutheran Church divests from Israel and curses Israel last Saturday, so God sends 6.9 trillion gallons of water. Wait, let me say that again. 6.9 trillion gallons of water to Louisiana. Over 20 inches of rain over the state. 20 inches of rain. 40,000 homes have damage to them. 40,000 homes. How many people don't have a place to live? And in California, 80,000 people have been displaced by the fire. So here, we want to circumcise our hearts. Look at verse 6 again. And Yehovah, your Elohim, will circumcise your hearts and the hearts of your children so that you will love your Elohim with all your heart, with all your being, and thus you will live. So when Paul's talking about in that Roman scripture, you got to be circumcised inwardly, it means a choice that each person must make. Each person must make a choice to be born again. What does being born again mean? It means circumcising your heart to the things of above. You never looked at it that way, did you? In Yochanan 3, where you got the born again passage, you got Yeshua, a Jew, talking to Nicodemus, a Jew, you know, the Kohen HaGadol, pretty smart guy. Okay, he's going to know something about the Word of God. So Yeshua says to him, I tell you of things of heaven, you got to understand it. You have to be born of spirit. You have to be born of spirit. That means you need a circumcised heart. And what is a spiritual circumcised heart? You got to want and desire the things of God. Wow. That's like powerful. Like, dude, let's now go, let's follow it up. Let's see if it's more than one place. Turn to Devarim, Deuteronomy 10 now. Deuteronomy 10, verse 12 through 17. Deuteronomy 10, verse 12 through 17. This part's called Don't Be Stiff-Neck Any Longer. Deuteronomy, Divarim 10, verse 12 through 17. So now, Yisrael, all that Yehovah your Elohim asks from you is to fear Yehovah your Elohim, follow all his ways, love him, and serve Yehovah your Elohim with all your heart, with all your being, to obey for your own good the mitzvot and the regulations of Yehovah, which I am giving you today. See the sky, the heaven beyond, the sky, the earth, and everything on it? All belong to Yehovah your Elohim. Only Yehovah took enough pleasure in your ancestors to love them and choose their descendants after them, yourselves above all peoples, and he still does today. Therefore, circumcise the foreskin of your heart and don't be stiff-necked any longer. Yehovah your Elohim is Elohim of gods, the Lord of lords, a great, mighty, and awesome God who has no favorites and accepts no bribes. Amen. Look at verse 16. It's a key verse of the ones we just read. Therefore, circumcise the foreskin of your heart and don't be stiff-necked any longer. Amen. Okay. To understand what Rav Sha'ul is saying in Romans 2, verses 28 and 29, you must first understand to stop being stiff-necked any longer. Well, what does stiff-neck any longer mean? What is he talking about there? Go back to verse 12. What does a stiff neck mean? Go back to verse 12. So now, Yisrael, all that Yehovah your Elohim asks from you is to fear Yehovah your Elohim, follow his ways, love him, and serve Yehovah your Elohim with all your heart and all your being. Amen? Okay, so what is not being stiff-neck anymore is following Yehovah's ways, serving him the way he wants to be served, not the way you want to serve, okay? Serving him. You know, you can pray over that ham for Christmas all you want. God's not going to bless it. You can celebrate Christmas all you want knowing it's Saturnalia, but you just put a Jesus bow on top of it and call it, you know, I like giving presents, it's a happy time. You can call that all you want, it's not going to work. You can celebrate Tisha B'Av all you want instead of the reason that you're celebrating Tisha B'Av, the destruction of the temple. Okay? So here, the way you stop being stiff-necked is what? Circumcise the foreskin of your heart. How do you do that? How do you circumcise the foreskin of your heart? How do you do it? Well, verse 12 says, follow his ways and love him. Follow his ways and love him. Follow his ways and love him. Well, what does love mean? What does Yeshua say love? If you love me, you'll keep my commandments. Follow his ways. Well, what does that mean? There's 34 categories of the law that we've gone over. You don't have to do all of it because some laws are for women, some laws are for men. Some laws are for the corner of your field, but if you don't own a field, you don't have to worry about the corner of your field. Right? Right? Amen? Do I got an amen? You got an amen? Okay. So, if you know you don't own business, you don't got to do the ones for business. You know, people get stuck on ham sandwiches, and sometimes I do because it's simple, but there's things about business. There's things about owning a home. Like, if you don't own a house, you don't have to worry about the rules for the roof. Because you don't own a house. It's not your job, okay? So to have the beginnings of a spiritual circumcised heart, you have to fear God, fear Yehovah your Elohim, and follow his ways. Fear and follow go hand in hand, hand in hand, okay? If you fear God, you're going to follow his ways because you know the curses are coming if you don't follow his ways. Well, we're under grace. Good luck with that. Good luck with that. Okay? Now let's see what else we got here. Let's go to verse 12 and 13 because this is another one that people get messed up on. So now, Yisrael, all that Yehovah your Elohim asks from you is to fear Yehovah your Elohim, follow all his ways, love him and serve Yehovah, your Elohim, with all your heart, with all your being. To obey for your own good the mitzvot and regulations of Yehovah, which I'm giving you today. Amen? The Seventh-day Adventists say we only got to follow the Ten Commandments. Okay. Let's just say they're correct. Now, in verse 13, we have a key understanding. It says mitzvot, commandments, and regulation, the precepts. The mitzvot is what? Keep the Shabbat holy. The regulation is how do you keep it holy? The circumcised heart doesn't just follow, what the Lord is saying here is not just the commandments, but also how to follow the commandment. Now, what are we not supposed to do on Shabbat? Okay? We're not to work. Okay? Or make other people work. So if you're going to a restaurant after you're done with your service, you're now making somebody else work. You're causing them to stumble. If nobody were going there, then the restaurant would be closed. Okay? The mitzvot is keep the Sabbath holy. But if you're going out and you're making somebody else cook, well, I didn't cook, Lord, then you're just being Talmudic. Okay? The Jews here in New York hire Gentiles to come into their house and turn on their heat. They hire Gentiles for the Shabbat to turn on their lights. You know, what are you doing? You're not keeping the Sabbath holy because I didn't do it. Do you think God is stupid? Yes, you know, God is stupid. I can think around God. I didn't do it, God. You're going to get up to him and he's like, you paid somebody. You told them to come into your house and do it. So here, the mitzvot and regulation is that we're not to cook on Shabbat or make somebody else cook. Okay? The mitzvot for Shabbat is no marital relations. Okay? The mitzvot for Shabbat, you know, there's so many we can go through, and we've gone through that. But the beginning of a circumcised heart is not only the commandment, but how to follow the commandment. Not a circumcised heart is one that doesn't want to think around it. That's what people try to do. A circumcised heart that Rav Sha'ul, you can have, what did we read in Romans 2? No, you can have the outward appearance. Oh, yes, he looks very Jewish. He's got the big beard. He's got the tallit on. You know, and you know, if I had a kippah on, oh, he's got such a beautiful kippah. You know, he's got the tefillin. You know, he's got, oh, look at the big tzitzit he's got. You know, he's got really big tzitzit. He knows how to put his tallit on nicely. But the guy's like thinking, you know, you want to get around the law. Fear is knowing that if God catches you, what the ramifications of that, what you did, what he's going to do to you. So if you want a circumcised heart, for your look at verse 13. Look what it says. To obey for your own good the mitzvot and regulation of Yehovah, which I'm giving you today. A circumcised heart, that's what Paul is talking about. This is what the church doesn't have. This is what many Messianic congregations don't have. A circumcised heart. A circumcised heart means serving God the way he wants. Stopping everything on Shabbat, sundown. Making sure you're at the Kadosh Mikra. If you're within 2 hours of a place, you should go. Okay? Oh, I can't make it. It's too much money. So take your tithe money and say, you say to the person that's running the congregation, I can't tithe because I used all my money to get a ride here. I'm sure the rabbi or the pastor would say, that's all right. Don't worry. You're here. You're not breaking the command. That's a good and positive way to serve God. Okay, let's go to verse 16. Therefore, circumcise the foreskin of your heart and don't be stiff-necked any longer. Don't be stiff-necked. People try, you know, they're looking for God. They want to be like Yeshua. Stop being stiff-necked. You can't tell me one instance in all the Brit HaDasha where it says to switch to Sabbath. Stop being stiff-necked. You can't say in one place it says to do away with God's holy days. Yeshua said, do away with these holy days because, you know, I'm done with them. No, he said, I finished the race. It's finished. I finished the race. That's what he's talking about. Okay? Don't be stiff-necked any longer. The first part about getting a spiritual circumcision is to stop being stiff-necked. I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. I can't do that. People won't like me. Who do you want to like you? Who's the only person that you should really be caring about is Yeshua, is God, his Father, Ruach HaKodesh, and they are one. Okay? That's who you should care about, because this life is short. So the first part that you want to do here, this part of this spiritual circumcision, is stop being stiff-necked. You read it, you do it. It's that simple. People are the ones that make it hard. You don't trust in God. You want blessings, then you got to stop being stiff-necked any longer. Now let's go on to verse 17. Verse 17. For Yehovah Elohim is Elohim of Elohims, the Lord of Lords, the great, mighty, and awesome Elohim, who has no favorite and accepts no bribes. Amen? He has no favorites. When you read the book of Daniel, chapter 6, Darius, the king, knows God. A Gentile knows God, proclaims God. Okay? God has no favorites. He has different jobs. Israel is the apple of his eye, very special to him. But a Gentile who wants to follow God's ways is as special to him. Remember, we all can't be hands. We all can't be eyes. The eye can't pick up the cup. The eye points the hand to the cup. The hand picks up the cup. They work in tangent with one another. Okay? So we all have different jobs. A woman carries a baby, but she needs a man to impregnate her, only her husband. Okay? The two become one flesh. And if God wants to, he will then bless the union with a child. Okay? But both don't carry the baby, only the woman, the one without the Y chromosome. I know we have a lot of idiots out there saying, I want to be a boy, I want to be a girl. Only men have Y chromosomes. Women don't. God said, you're never going to change that. You're never going to change it. Okay? God has no favorites. He's looking for people that want to change their lives, that want a circumcised heart, that don't want the garbage anymore, but only want the best. Now let's follow that up. Does this go to the prophets? So we see that Rav Sha’ul was talking about Torah with Romans 2, a circumcised heart. Now let's go to Jeremiah, Yirmiyahu chapter 4, please. Yirmiyahu chapter 4. Jeremiah chapter 4, verse 1 through 4. Jeremiah 4, verse 1 through 4. This part is called, get away from the Gentile pagan stuff and be set apart. Yirmiyahu, Jeremiah chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. Israel, if you will return, says Jehovah, yes, return to me, and if you banish your abominations from my presence without wandering astray again, and if you will swear as Jehovah lives, in truth, justice, and righteousness, then the nations will bless themselves by him, and in him will they glory. For here's what Jehovah says to the people of Yehuda and Jerusalem. Break up your ground that hasn't been plowed, and do not sow among the thorns. People of Yehuda and inhabitants of Jerusalem, circumcise yourselves for Jehovah. Remove the foreskin of your heart, otherwise my fury will lash out like fire, burning so hot that no one can quench it because of how evil your actions are. Amen? Go back to verse 4 again. People of Yehuda and inhabitants of Jerusalem, circumcise yourselves for Jehovah. Remove the foreskins of your heart. Otherwise, my fury will lash out like fire, burning so hot that no one can quench it because of how evil your actions are. Amen? Who has to circumcise your heart? It is you yourself. Circumcise yourselves for Jehovah. Remove the foreskin of your heart. Well, what is a foreskin? It is something that covers. Take off the cover and let something be bare. Let it be exposed. Take off that top layer and let your heart be exposed. Because if you don't, then God's fury what we're about to see in the world, his fury is going to lash out at us. It's going to lash out like fire. The firefighters in California, these guys have been fighting fires for years and years and years, has said we have never seen a fire like this ever before. Must be when you want to say we can murder the old person because they're just going to die anyway. Or somebody's too sick, we don't want to take care of them anymore. Let's just murder them. Let's give them drugs so they just go to sleep and never wake up. God says, all right, I've had enough. I've had enough. I'm going to burn down your houses. I won't take your lives except for a few people, but I'm going to burn down everything that you hold dear to you. So here in verse 4, let's read that again. People of Yehuda and inhabitants of Yerushalayim, circumcise yourselves for Jehovah. Remove the foreskins of your heart. Otherwise, my fury will lash out like fire, burning so hot that no one can quench it because of how evil your actions are. Well, let's go back to find out what he's talking about in verse 4. Go back to verse 1. What are these evil actions? Go back to verse 1. It's all about the circumcision of a heart. This is what Rav Sha'ul, we're going to go back to Romans later, but we're going to understand what he's talking about. What would Rav Sha'ul be reading? He'd be reading the Torah, the prophets, and the writings. He would not be reading the New Testament or even the Gospels. Jeremiah 4, verse 1. What is this fire? What's going to happen? Why? Israel, if you will return, says Jehovah, yes, return to me. And if you will banish your abominations from my presence without wandering astray again. Amen? Banishing the pagan garbage from your life. Anything that God says is unholy, get it out. Okay? Get that garbage out of your life. You want to enter into the kingdom of God? You want to be really born again? Then you got to circumcise your heart. You have to choose heaven over the things of man. Man-made religion, garbage. Get the Christmas tree, get the ham, get the Sunday worship, get all that stuff, get the Talmudic stuff out, get all that stuff out of your life and return to God. Banish it from your life. Banish it from your life. Banish these abominations, these other gods, these other ways of doing things, these other foods that are not food at all. Get them out of your life. Banish them from your life. Get them out of his presence. Circumcise your own heart for the things of God. What is an abomination? What is a to'eba? The word abomination is a to'eba. Homosexuality is a to'eba, is an abomination. Get that stuff out of your society. Get this garbage out of here. Remove it. If they want to push back, get them out. Make laws that if you're found, you're in jail. Okay? Oh, that's too harsh. How will they receive salvation? I don't care. I want to serve God, and God said, get these abominations out of our lives. You want a circumcised heart. You want a spiritual circumcised heart. What do you got to do? You can't allow this garbage into your town, into your homes, into nothing. Okay? What else would that be? Women wearing tzitzit is a to'eba. A woman wearing tzitzit is the same as homosexuality. Get this abomination out of your culture, out of your congregation, out of the place. Get it out of the Lord's presence. Remove it. If you're doing it yourself, you know, some of the women that we had here, they would have their head covered, but they put tzitzit on the end of their head covering. Oh, brilliant. Brilliant. Just absolutely brilliant. Because your husband wasn't taking on his job, so you had to take it on yourself? No. Seek the Lord thy God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Then he'll move mountains for you. Return to God. Banish this stuff. Verse 1. Israel, if you will return, says Jehovah, yes, return to me. If you will banish your abominations from my presence without wandering astray again. That means making a covenant. Circumcision. You know, I want to be born again. I want salvation. You want to be born again? Well, then you got to banish the garbage out of your life. You got to find out what the garbage is. And how do I know what the garbage is that I shouldn't have? What is this abomination? Where am I going to find the definition for an abomination? Oh, everybody now. 613. Lives in me. Okay? It lives in us. It lives in us. Okay? You got to banish these abominations. What would the king say is an abomination? You know? So here, let's take the flip side of this. You know, at the cross, Yeshua said it's finished. The Christians say the law is done. All right, let's take the argument. Let's do a poll on that argument. Okay, well, homosexuality is okay now. Yay! Okay, well, since the law is done, you know, homosexuality is okay, right? No. Okay, gambling's okay. Yes, I want to go gambling. I want to go to Atlantic City. I want to go to Las Vegas. Yes, because whatever stays in Vegas, whatever happens in Vegas, it stays in Vegas. That's right. That's what I want. I want to go to Rio de Janeiro during Carnival. Yes. Ooh, yes. See all the naked women dancing around. Yes, because the law is over. Because I can do it because I live under grace. I can have sex with my mommy because mommy's a hot mama. Okay, but the law is done, right? I can eat dog poop because that's good. I can have sex with a cow. I can steal from my neighbor. I can covet my neighbor's wife. Because why? The law is done. The Lord says, get these abominations. That's what the nations do. That's what the pagans do. Get that Christmas tree, that God out of your house. Okay? Research what it is. Gambling's okay. Fornication's okay. Sunday worship. You know, you say those all those things are bad. But then Sunday worship is in the same category. You see, God says, get the abominations out of my face. Circumcise your heart for my stuff. And then I will bless you, and I'll even bless your children. Conversely, the antonym of this is, you want to go do all those things, gambling, homosexuality, cross-dressing. I feel like a girl today. I feel like a Muppet tomorrow. I feel like a giraffe today. I feel like a donkey tomorrow. You know, whatever floats your boat today, all this silly stuff. God says, be steady, follow my ways. Look at verse 1 again. Israel, if you will return, says Jehovah, yes, return to me, and if you will banish nations from my presence without wandering astray again. Amen? Return. What are we returning to? What are we returning to? God's perfect laws. If you return to my perfect laws, God says, I'll bless you. If you stop seeking after other pagan gods, I'll bless you. If you circumcise your heart for my word, my ways, my holy day, my kosher laws, my type of marriage, my business practices, then I will bless you more than you can possibly imagine. Look at verse 4. People of Yehuda and inhabitants of Yerushalayim, circumcise yourselves for Jehovah. Remove the foreskins of your heart. Otherwise, my fury will lash out like fire, burning so hot that no one can quench it because of how evil your actions are. Amen? Aren't we living in this world today? But the choice of circumcision, the choice of being born again to circumcise your own heart, remove the foreskins of your heart. Take off the covering. Take off the defenses that I can't cover my hair. I can't wear CTO. I can't let my beard grow. It doesn't really say let your beard. Yes, it does. Let your beards grow. Why have a beard at all if you're not going to let it grow? What makes us different? It makes us look different. That's what God wants. His people look different. We dress different. We speak different. We wear different clothing. That's why he gave us a tallit. Okay? We're supposed to be different. Long beards wake you up in the middle of the night because you feel like you're choking yourself. Okay? Did I always have this? No. I fought with God. As soon as I did this, 7 years ago, this is about how long it is. No. About 5 years ago. All of a sudden, more people started to come. I did nothing different. God said, he just started to bless. Bless. You want to be like Yeshua? Remember, they pulled his beard out. If he had a short beard, you can't grab it. They ripped his beard out in the Isaiah scripture, it says. They plucked his beard out. Not one by one, grabbed it and ripped it from his face. That's why his face was unrecognizable. Circumcise yourself. Circumcise yourself. Go to Ezekiel 11. Ezekiel 11. You learn anything? Ezekiel 11, verse 17 to 21. We'll have a lot more of this message in tomorrow's message. We'll be going to the book of Daniel to start off. Ezekiel 11, verse 17 through 21. A heart of stone for a heart of flesh. Ezekiel 11, verse 17 through 21. Verse 17 through 21. Therefore, say that Jehovah Elohim says this, I will gather you from the peoples and collect you from the countries where you have been scattered, and I will give the land of Israel to you. Then they will go there and remove all its loathsome things and disgusting practices. And I will give them unity of heart, echad. I will put a new spirit among you. I will remove from their bodies the hearts of stone and give them hearts of flesh, so that they will live by my regulations and obey my rulings and act by them. Then they will be my people and I will be their God. But as for those hearts, go after the heart of the loathsome things and the disgusting practices, I will bring the consequences of their ways on their own heads, says Jehovah Elohim. Amen. Let's go back to verse 18 and 19, please. 18 and 19. Then they will go there and remove all its loathsome things and disgusting practices. And I will give them unity of heart. I will put a new spirit among you. I will remove from their bodies the hearts of stone and give them a heart of flesh. Amen. That's a beautiful passage. But what do we have to do? You have to remove the loathsome things and disgusting practices. How do I know what is a loathsome thing or a disgusting practice? That would be found in the Torah. If you want to have a circumcised heart, you have to remove the loathsome things. Sunday worship is loathsome to God. It is disgusting. It was made by Constantine and Pope Sylvester I. The Talmudim, the disciples, never did that. Even in the book of Acts, when Paul and Barnabas, Rav Sha’ul and Barnabas, were in the town, and the whole town came to hear the word, and they were like, when can we hear this again? Paul didn't say, tomorrow, it's Sunday, we worship on Sunday. No, what did he say? Next Shabbat. So we see that it's still, the Shabbat was still going, because the fourth commandment is still the fourth commandment. I focus on that because a lot of people are on the beginning of their journey. It's a simple thing to focus on. The further you are in your journey, the more responsible you are. Okay? How do we circumcise our heart? We remove the disgusting practices. Some people men like to ogle women. Oh, that's nice. Oh, she's got a great body. I just want to admire her. I like watching the Olympics because of the gymnasts. I love watching the Summer Olympics. I love gymnastics. Yeah, I used to love watching gymnastics too. A gymnast body, woo, goodness gracious, look at how powerful that girl is. Yes, sir. You know, I did think the gymnasts, the men on the rings that could do the Iron Cross, man, that guy was strong. I'm like, Jiminy Crickets, I was like there for like a half a second, could never do that. And it's like, that is amazing. Some of the athletes are amazing. But what is a disgusting practice? How will I know what a disgusting practice is? As Ezekiel, how will I know? Well, what would Ezekiel be reading? The Torah. That's going to tell you what is good and what is bad. What God thinks is really disgusting and an abomination, and what he thinks is loathsome. And it's like somebody coming in and they haven't used underarm deodorant or something like that. Or they got poop all over them, or they haven't bathed in a month. Okay? You're like, I don't want that guy sitting next to me. Right. Why? It's a loathsome thing. But what is loathsome to God? Are you doing something that is loathsome to God? It's not me that you got to impress. It's him that you got to impress. And then he says what in verse 19? I'm going to remove their heart of stone and give them a heart of flesh. I'm going to remove the heart of stone and give them a heart of flesh. And since Yeshua is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and he never changes, an abomination to him then is still an abomination to us today. It doesn't change. He didn't come here to change anything, but to show you his own personal example, to say, follow me. Celebrating pagan holidays is still loathsome to him, no matter what you call it. Well, it's Christmas. Well, it's really about the evergreen tree. Yeah, Jeremiah Tessin, don't bring that in your house because that's a god. You bow down to it. I don't bow down to it. You put the presents under it. Okay, whatever it is. New Year's Eve. Oh, it's nothing real. You know, there's a Messianic congregation here in Jersey. You know, on New Year's Eve at midnight, they sound the shofar. You really think that's what God wants? Where do I find that in Scripture? Since the day changes when the sun goes down, not at midnight, where the pagans say the witches come out from 1 in the morning till 3 in the morning. Study witchcraft and understand it. What is loathsome to God? Where would I find these things? In the Torah. So if you want a circumcised heart, you got to get rid of the things. If you want the things that are loathsome to God, you want God to come by you, you got to come by Him. There's a song that a lot of people know, "Kumbaya, my Lord, Kumbaya." When we were in Africa, they were singing, "Kumbaya, my Lord, Kumbaya." Do you know what that means? It means come by me. Come by me, Lord. Come by me. Come by me, Lord. Come by me. And it goes on to, though none shall follow, still I will follow. Get rid of the loathsome things. Circumcise your own heart. It's your life. Your life. Now let's go back to Romans. Romans 2, verse 25 through 29. Now that you understand, now let's read it in context. Have you learned something here today? Romans 2, verse 25 to 29. For the circumcision is indeed of value if you do what Torah says. But if you are a transgressor of the Torah, your circumcision has become uncircumcision. Therefore, If an uncircumcised man keeps the righteous requirements of the Torah, won't his uncircumcision be counted as circumcision? Indeed, the man who is physically uncircumcised but obeys the Torah will stand as a judgment on you who have had Brit Milah and have Torah written out but violate it. For the real Jew is not merely Jewish outwardly. True circumcision is not only external and physical. On the contrary, a real Jew is one inwardly, and true circumcision is of the heart, spiritual, not literal, so that his praise comes not from other people, but from God. Amen? Now, the Gentile loves to look at verse 26 to say we don't have to be circumcised. Let's look at back 26. Therefore, and if an uncircumcised man keeps the righteous requirements of the Torah, won't his uncircumcision be counted as circumcision? Well, if he keeps the righteous requirements of Torah, that means he got circumcised. Because the righteous requirements of Torah, you know, isn't just at the eighth day to be circumcised. Remember, how old was Abraham? How old was Ishmael? Okay, the righteous requirements of Torah found in Leviticus 12. Okay, the righteous requirements of Torah. Now go to verse 28 and 29. For the real Jew is not merely Jewish outwardly. True circumcision is not only external and physical. On the contrary, the real Jew is one inwardly, and true circumcision is of the heart, spiritual, not literal, so that his praise comes not from other people, but from God. Amen? Spiritual, not literal, okay? The first part about being born again is to be circumcising your own heart, choosing heaven. True circumcision of the heart is obedience to God's commandments, not being stiff-necked any longer, doing what God says, not wanting the curses anymore, but wanting the blessing. A true circumcision is becoming a real Jew inside, not just outside with a tallit, tzitzit, and a big beard, okay? A real Jew follows Torah, not Paul. Look at verse 26 and 27. Therefore, if an uncircumcised man keeps the righteous requirements of the Torah, won't his uncircumcision be counted as circumcision? Indeed, the man who is physically uncircumcised but obeys the Torah will stand as a judgment on you who had Brit Milah, and have Torah written out, but violate it. Amen. You can have the Torah, but you're violating it. You're violating it by pornography, by not keeping the Sabbath holy, by not wanting to be there on the Sabbath. And the circumcision is important. The physical circumcision has to happen because keeping the Torah, you can't eat Passover unless you get circumcised, man. So you must be circumcised of heart and of flesh. Because Yeshua said, do this in remembrance of me. Do what? Eat matzah and drink wine? No. The Passover, the lamb. You do it because Yeshua did it. You follow him. Go to our last scripture. Two more minutes. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17. 2 Corinthians, capítulo 5, versículo 17. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17. Now you're going to understand what Paul is writing about. He's not saying get rid of the Torah. Actually, he's confirming it. Therefore, if anyone is united with Messiah, he is a new creation. The old has passed. Look, what has come is fresh and new. Amen? Fresh and new, meaning that means he's got a circumcised heart. You're united with Messiah because Messiah is the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word became flesh. The flesh became circumcised. The flesh was seen by everybody. You become a new creation when you stop being stiff-necked and say, we don't have to follow these things anymore. Anybody who says you don't have to follow these things anymore is following Satan, and therefore they are not born again. Being a new creation means you have a circumcised heart for the things of Messiah. Circumcision done by Messiah, for he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. If you want to get into heaven, you must be born again. And how do you get born again? Is you follow the 613. You say, I want that. I don't want to be stiff-necked any longer. I want to follow God. I want to follow his ways. I want to follow the way, the truth, and the life.
Shalom. This is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman. I would personally like to thank you for tuning in to the Remnant's Call each and every week. You can listen to the full message on our website, bethgoyim.org. If you have drawn closer to the King of Kings, learned more about him today, we are blessed. If you are blessed by these messages, please consider a donation to our ministry. You can go to our website, bethgoyim.org. That's BETHGOYIM.org. And click on the donate button. You do not have to have a PayPal account to donate. All you need is a debit card. Once again, thank you very much for listening to The Remnant's Call.
If you have not taken your first steps to be born again, just ask God's help. Remember, it's His loving grace that has come to find you. No one is worthy or able to reach God, but God can reach us, and He's reaching out to you now. Just open your heart and let Him in. His arms are open, and the blessing of salvation and eternal life are waiting for you. Don't let it wait any longer.
Shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you and give you his shalom.
Shalom. My name is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman, and I invite you to come to visit our congregation. If you are in the tri-state area,
come out and visit with us on Shabbat. We are a congregation of Jews and Gentiles, living as one in the Messiah Yeshua. BGMC is a place of true worship. The focus never wanders from the Hebraic roots of our faith. Beth Goyim is rooted in the Word of God from Bereshit through to the Book of Revelation. Messiah's strong words against man-made tradition are carefully recorded in Matthew 7. That is the reason we only follow the straight-up instructions found in Scripture. Truly, the way, the truth, and the life. If you're looking for a deeper walk with Adonai, come out for our Tuesday evening Bible study called Messianic Torah Time. Come, spend the day with us on any Shabbat. We start at 11 a.m. with the sound of the ancient Hebrew shofar. Next, we offer our King praise and worship in English, Hebrew, and Spanish. After worship, we review the headlines in the previous week's news from around the globe, especially news from the Holy Land Israel. We don't just list the news headlines as current events, but we comb through the scriptures, searching for clues to understand what they mean, and then to help pinpoint prophetically our current position on Adonai's clock. After digesting all that modern information, we leave the world behind as we journey with our Adonai deep into his eternal word, not with just one or two scriptures, but usually seven or more scriptures. The spiritual nourishment and the richness of his kingdom become accessible to the ones who share this special time and seek them out. The day does not end there. Because Shabbat is so special to him, there is always so much more that our King desires to share. So instead of separating and leaving, we stay together as a family for potluck lunch and an afternoon study of our King's Word. We close this Shabbat together with the reading of the new week's parasha. That's the Torah portion. Even after those blessings, many of us just can't get enough. So the members bring prepared homemade foods to share while we all enjoy an uplifting movie together. If all that information is not quite enough, you can check out our website where you will find over 200 video teachings and biblical holy day studies. Under Messianic Torah Time, the Hebrew Roots button, you'll discover free studies on many, many different topics, including PowerPoint slide presentations. If Beth Goyim sounds like a place you'd love to visit, but you live outside the tri-state area, there is still a way to connect with us. We stream live on the internet on Tuesday, Thursday, and Shabbat. The website is www.bethgoyim.org. That's BethGoyim.org. Our phone number is 973-338-7800 or 978-2-YESHUA. That's 978, the number 2, Yeshua. Shalom.